Good afternoon, friends. Thank you very much. The organizer, of course, Sanjeev, has done a marvelous job getting so many people across for such a distant areas, I mean, from all across the country, and kudos to him to bring the concept. And I think, you know, we heard about nephrologists becoming interventionalists, which is extremely important. And I think we have to move on beyond kidney transplantation. Of course, that's a very, very important aspect of nephrology, but I think probably more number of patients are undergoing dialysis rather than kidney transplant. So I think we have to access and focus on to patients who are going to be living this way. You are actually going to be prolonging their lives doing this. So it's extremely important. Two important concepts about fistulas which we talk about. One is, no fistula is precious. I mean, you know, we have this thing about fistula. This is a precious fistula. There's no such thing as a precious fistula. All fistulas are precious. Whenever you make a fistula, the first fistula is as precious as any other fistula that you ever want to make. So it's extremely important that you have to make sure that you do not, you know, it shouldn't be that I make one, if it doesn't work, I'll do the second, then I do the third, fourth, fifth, and sixth, and you just keep going on. So that's not something that needs to be done. So we need to preserve each and every fistula that's possible. I think as the fistulas go on, this is just some histopathology of patients undergoing. So this is natural progression of disease. The veins are going to undergo myointimal hyperplasia, and this is essentially what happens. So to keep this open, you have to stretch them, you have to do some form of procedure to keep these veins open by some sort of fistulplasty. So this is something, this is an extremely difficult case that we've still got running. Fortunately, Dr. Kher is in the audience, and I'm sure he'd know, because this was one of his patients. This is a 65-year-old man on maintenance hemodialysis. He had multiple attempts of failed AV fistulas, both arms completely gone. He had exhausted his right internal jugular and both his femorals. And one day, I mean, we didn't know him till then. Of course, all this was going on, at different centers. So one day we got a call from our dialysis center that there's no flow, but there is a pulsatile fistula. That means the fistula is working, but there is no flow through, so you can't undergo, patient can't undergo dialysis. We did a Doppler examination on the spot, and we found that the cephalic, it was basically a brachiocephalic fistula, and the cephalic up to the arch was occluded, and the flow was being diverted through some collateral up into the deep veins. So what were the options? We tried to open up this arch. We went through by puncturing into the cephalic vein. We went in. We just were not able to do so. We just could not negotiate the arch, and in terms of that was failed. Then, of course, the patient needed dialysis, so we had to, at that time, wanted to put in a permacath, but the patient at that point of time did not have access. I mean, he had come in for dialysis and he suddenly required this procedure, so he did not agree to put in a permacath. So we put in a temporary line through the left internal jugular for him to undergo dialysis. And now the options was, could we divert the flow from the patent cephalic into one of the basilic veins, into one of the deeper veins, and try and get the flow through, which is exactly what we did. We got a piece of long saphenous vein. As a surgeon, we are endovascular surgeons, so we got a piece of long saphenous vein from the groin, and there you see in the middle, that is a jump graft that we did from the patent cephalic up into the deep veins, and we got the flow through, and we got some very, very good flows through, and this patient went back to dialysis straight away. We, of course, kept the temp line because we weren't sure whether this was going to work, because this wasn't something that we were doing regularly. But of course, this continued for about 2 months, and then it failed again. Obviously, that's not surprising. The long saphenous vein jump graft that we had done again sort of failed on us, and the vein, the thrill was lost, and the fistula was again only pulsatile with no flow through. And this showed, and the Doppler showed, a severe stenosis of the long saphenous vein off the interposition graft that we had done. And that is, of course, so we again went in and we said, now this was the only, don't forget that this was the only fistula site that was available. This patient needed that fistula. So we went in and said, let's see, trying to keep it alive. So we went in, and there you can see a stenosis right in the middle of the long saphenous jump graft that we had done, which we balloon dilated, and we had this waste which was opened up, and you saw a fairly good flow through. And we said, okay, that's wonderful. So now what was the reason why this happened? We went in, and lo and behold, of course, because I told you we had a temp line in there, and this patient also had a central venous stenosis. Probably that was the reason why having a backflow. So again, what we did, we managed to pass and cross through the central venous stenosis, and we balloon dilated that as well. We got a good flow through. Again, this carried on for another 1.5 to 2 months. And then this long saphenous vein jump graft and the proximal cephalic vein started to show reduced flows during dialysis. This was way back, if you can see right up top, this is April 27th, 2016, last year. April, and this started. So at that point of time, we thought, let's try and do something different. We went in and put in a covered graft in this area, completely covering our internal jugular, the long saphenous vein jump graft that we had placed. This carried on, believe it or not, surprisingly for us, for over a year. This patient came back to us on the 19th of June 2017. You can see it up there, and this graft was still running. This graft was still running, the stent graft that we had placed was still running. You can see very good flows, but I don't know whether you can notice this, but there is the beginning of new intimal hypoplasia at the edge. This is now started coming up. So here again, as we said, we went in, and this time we did a balloon angioplasty and a drug eluting balloon. So this is something that we've done again now here. This is the 19th of June 2017, and till today, fortunately, this patient's dialysis is still being conducted through the patent fistula and this. So the chronology of events, as I would tell you, is that we saw him the first time in November 2015. We tried to do a plain old balloon angioplasty, did not work. The cephalic vein had thrombosed. The balloon angioplasty failed. We put in a long saphenous vein jump graft, an open surgical procedure. That too failed in about 2 to 4 months. This we tried to repeatedly open on two occasions over 4 months with a plain old balloon angioplasty, continued for about 4 months, and then we stented the long saphenous jump graft, and that gave us 1 year. And then, of course, now he's developing an edge stenosis for which we have used a drug eluting balloon. So this was the chronology of events which actually allowed us, which we followed to try and keep this one fistula patent. And, I mean, yes, you can. I'm sure there'll be questions in the audience at what cost. But my question to that would be, what is the alternative? What do we do? We have no other access left. Of course, we could have put in one of these IVC lines, but then that's a line. This is a fistula. And we have to try and, as I said, salvage each and every millimeter of fistula that we have to try and keep it open, because that is your lifeline of these patients, and this is something that we really need to put in all our efforts to do. So I'm glad Dr. Jasuja has actually helped us all, bring us together. We are all interested in the patency of the fistula so that these patients, unfortunately, can be kept on long-term maintenance dialysis. Of course, it adds to a huge amount of additional burden to these patients who are already suffering, reeling from the other comorbid conditions of CKD, which would require multiple clinic and hospital visits and multiple angioplasties and other procedures. But I'm sure it is well worth trying if the outcomes, including that is survival and cost, are encouraging. I think that is something that is a lesson to take home from here. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this option, but I just have, just one last minute. I still have that 1 minute. And I said, I must congratulate Dr. Jasuja again here. It is the avatar. It's a one grand step towards creating an interventional nephrologist. We heard in the beginning of this session that how nephrology has evolved, and now the nephrologists are becoming interventional nephrologists. I think that's an extremely, extremely important and a positive step, because nephrologists have the onus of these patients. The CKD patients belong to them, and I think it is imperative that they can actually do things themselves, or if not, then try and get together a multidisciplinary team. Get a nephrologist who is, of course, the one who creates the fistula and runs them. The surgeon tries to help him around with difficult AV fistulas, putting in grafts, maybe a basilic vein transfer or anything else that is required. And of course, the interventionalist pops in every now and again with either some fistulaplasty or a central venousplasty, which is possible. Another one last word of caution. I know we all are very fond of putting in central venous lines, but believe me, they are the worst things that you can really do to these patients, because all the complications of fistulas primarily arise from putting in central venous lines, because the central venous obstructions are the most difficult to create, to treat, and that is what creates actually this patient. So this is something that we've created. I think Avatar is probably bringing about the vascular access interventionalists. That is a new breed of clinicians which should be able to actually look after these unfortunate patients. And because this is an increasing population of patients who will be requiring this thing. So this is again a little exposure. We've had this meeting. We have an endorsement of CDAP out here, which is Controversies in Dialysis Access Asia Pacific. And this is something that we've also created. It's a Vascular Access Society of India, which comprises of nephrologists, surgeons, interventionalists, and we should try and get hold of all these controversies and try and evolve a consensus so we can do that. We will be holding this meeting again on the 2nd and 3rd of February 2018 at the Westin Hotel in Gurgaon, and I would encourage and invite you all to attend that meeting. Thank you very much for the privilege.
Thank you very much, Dr. Parakh.